Hello guys, welcome back to my channel. Today I'm filming a long anticipated video. I have been looking forward to filming this video and we are talking about living car free. In this video we are going to talk about why we decided to get rid of our car. We are going to talk about the financial benefits and the environmental benefits. Then I'm going to tell you how we are managing without a car. Then I'm going to tell you the response of our surroundings, like going against the social norms with selling our car. And last but not least, I'm going to do a little bit of a reflection of how we feel about living car free for 7 months now. So if you are interested in one specific topic, then you can navigate through the chapters in the description box. And now let's get started with the first one, and that is why we decided to get rid of our car. A few years ago our old car was done, so we needed a new car, and we bought a Renault Megane Estate. We thought it was the most beautiful car on the market, and we absolutely loved that car. It was so shiny and new. We were super proud of that car. The car drove like a dream. So we were absolutely over the moon about it. It felt so special. And it was quite an expensive car, but we could afford it, so that was not a problem. So that car really made us feel amazing, at least in the beginning. Last Christmas holiday, my partner and I were thinking about how to further simplify our lives and how we could make a better impact, or less of an impact, on the environment actually. So I kind of said as a joke that we could sell our car and it would make a big difference in our environmental footprint. It would save us a ton of money, so we could probably work one day less every week. We kind of loved the idea, but also thought that it would not be realistic, that we would regret getting rid of our car, that we would not be able to manage without one. Yeah, the moment passed, but the idea was kind of stuck in our heads. So let me tell you a little bit more in depth of what the reasons were that we wanted to get rid of our car. So the first reason was that we want to make a smaller environmental impact and we want to take ownership of our actions. So instead of pointing at others and at companies what they should be doing to lower their impact, we want to look at what we could do to lower our environmental impact and take responsibilities for our own actions. And of course it would be great if companies and governments would take action, but that's not really within our direct reach. We just decided to look at ourselves and be the change that we want to see in the world. The second reason is that it would save us a lot of money. We think our time is the most valuable thing we have, along with our health. So we are very intentional with how we spend our time, because you never know if you will be here tomorrow. So we better make sure we enjoy the time we have here on this planet. We kind of see work as a trade of our time for the money we need to live. So if we can drastically lower the amount of money we need, we can have a lot more time to enjoy together. So our goal is to need as little money as possible so we can decide what we want to do with our time. And selling our car would make a big impact on our financial situation, and it would mean that we have to work a lot less hours, which was a very good reason for us to sell it. And I'm going to share with you a lot more in depth of how much the car exactly cost us with exact numbers later in this video, so stay tuned for that. The third reason is that we want to further simplify our lives. We want our lives to be easy and enjoyable, and we don't want to live without hurrying. And by driving a car, your body is already in stress mode, whether you notice it or not, because our bodies are just not wired or programmed to go as fast as driving. Because if you look at it from an evolutionary perspective, then our bodies are not supposed to go faster than running. So when we do go faster than that, our body is already in stress mode because we need to be responsive very quickly. And even if you think you are relaxed in the car, your body is kind of stressed. And then we're not even talking about the people on the road yet, because, oh man, traffic is just stressful, and not even to talk about rush hour or road rage. and we just didn't like dealing with that. And we also wanted to change our mentality because our Saturdays would usually be filled with errands and we would jump in and out of the car all Saturday, running around, racing around to get all of our errands done, and then in the afternoon we would get in the car again and go to family to visit them, and it all had to be done quickly and it was just a lot. We wanted to be more intentional of how we spend our time, and not having a car would force us to be more thoughtful of how we spend our time. So it may sound really cheesy, but it's true. Now that we do not have a car anymore, we also enjoy the ride and not only the destination. So in the following days after our first conversation, we started to take a more serious look at getting rid of our car and see if it would actually be possible. So we tried to think of all the ways in which we used our car, and we kind of categorized it into three categories. The first category was daily and weekly usage. On a daily and weekly basis, we used our car to go to work, to do groceries, to run errands, to visit family, and to go into nature. The second category is every now and then, and we would use our car every now and then to go to family that lives far away, and for transporting big items with our trailer. And the third category is once a year, and that was going camping. We decided that it would be possible to get rid of our car if we were able to manage our daily and weekly commute without a car, and then we would be able to manage the other two categories in alternative ways. So we decided to just give it a try. We left our car at home for an entire month and tried to go without it, and it was super doable, actually easier than expected. So after that month, the decision was made and we actually found out that we could easily go without a car. So what once was a super shiny, amazing new car, which drove like a dream, I will admit, just became a car. It just became an object to bring us from point A to point B, and it lost its shine in like, I don't know, a few years. And from the moment we decided to sell our car, it started to feel more like a burden than a luxury, if I'm being honest. I can tell you that it was a very expensive lesson, but a very important one to learn. Things are just things, despite the social status you may think it gives you. So we sold our car at the end of February. So now let's get into the juicy stuff. And let's share how much our car actually costs per month. I decided to calculate how much it cost us on average per month, so it could differ a little bit per month. I'm going to read it for you so I don't make mistakes. We had to pay every month taxes, 131 euros, our insurance, which was 60 euros, roadside assistance, 13 euros, fuel, 95 euros, depreciation, 200 euros. Maintenance, 28 euros. So our car cost us 537 euros per month on average. That's a lot. So on average, we drove 18,000 kilometers every year with our car, and our car drove 22 kilometers on 1 liter of fuel. So we save 820 liters of fuel with not having a car. And I know it's not a completely black and white picture like that. There's a lot of gray areas, which I will get into with how we managed to live without a car, but it is a big impact. Now let's continue with how we are actually managing to live without a car. For us, it's sadly not achievable to go completely without motorized transportation, because the public transport in the countryside is just not great. To explain to you how we manage our commute, we have to go back to our three categories from the beginning of the video, because we are going to start with our daily and weekly commute. Before we sold our car, we had one car and one scooter, which we shared. So we would take turns who would take the car to work and who would go by scooter. And we did this all year round, winter, summer, rain, storm, whatever. So we were already used to driving a scooter in bad weather. And in the Netherlands, scooters are allowed to go 45 kilometers an hour. So let's say 50 for convenience. We both work within 20 kilometers from home, so that's really doable by scooter. Sadly, we are both not able to take public transportation to work. So we decided we need a second scooter to be able to go to work year round. So we now have two scooters and two bikes, and that's our commute. Our commute is only going to be a problem if it would really start snowing here, which hardly ever happens. But last year was for the first time in ages that we had a ton of snow. In that scenario, we would not be able to go to work. But I think that's valid and okay, because if we would rely on public transportation, we would also not be able to go, because last year when there was so much snow, all public transportation was down, so many people were not able to go to work. So yeah, that's the only downside. And if we would actually have a lot of snow some years, then we would always be able to rent a car for like the week there is snow. So to give a little bit of a summary of the daily, weekly category, how we manage, we have work within 20 kilometers from home, we do our groceries by bike, we have family we see regularly that lives 40 kilometers away, and it takes us an hour to go there by scooter, so that's like the furthest distance we would go by scooter, but it is doable and it is okay. So that's how we manage to do to visit family. We are aware that our scooter still burns fuel, but it is a lot less than our car, because our scooter drives 35 kilometers on 1 liter of fuel and our car would drive only 22. So it is a big saving, and we also became a lot more conscious of our traveling habits, our transportation habits. So now we cut out all unnecessary commuting. We try to combine errands we have to run, and we take the bike way more often. So all in all, we make a lot less kilometers, even with our scooters. For the other categories, we have the every now and then category, which would be family far away and using the car with a trailer to get big objects. For instance, if we need to get wood for the fireplace. So we have a family member living quite close, which we can borrow a car from. So if we need to get wood, for instance, we could just borrow the car, and it is a good opportunity to drink a cup of tea together. And in exchange for borrowing the car, they can borrow our trailer whenever they need it. So it is a nice exchange and it works really well. And if we would want to visit family that lives further away, we could borrow their car or rent a car. But the first couple of times we borrowed the car, but we actually didn't really like that, because we were like, well, we sold our car and now we're borrowing a car and we're still driving. So in the summer holiday, we took the train for the first time to go see family that lives far away, and we really loved going by train. So that's probably what we will keep doing. And the last category is once a year, and once a year we would go camping. This year we didn't go camping, and we are not sure if we want to go camping next year or what we want to do, so we'll just figure it out by then. If we would want to go camping with a car, we could always rent one, but I'm not sure. We'll see. Going against social norms. It is not very socially accepted to not have a car. If you don't have a car, there must be something wrong. So when we told people we were going to sell our car, their immediate reaction is they think that we can't afford a car or we have financial struggles. But when you tell them that's not the case, it's not that we can't afford a car, it is just that we don't want to spend that much money on a car, people just think you're weird and they don't understand it. And it also made it quite clear that people always think from their own perspective and their own interests. So almost all of our family members immediately asked, but how are you going to visit us in the future? And some of them were afraid that we would come visit less often if we didn't have a car. Some people also kind of feel like it is a personal attack on them, and they will get upset and annoyed, and they will explain why they absolutely need a car and why they have one. It is kind of the same as when you tell people you are vegetarian. They will just start to explain why they eat meat, and that's not really the issue, but I'm just telling what I'm doing. I'm not saying you're doing something wrong. I think it's because people become aware of an issue that they didn't want to be aware of. So they start explaining their behavior and trying to talk it into being okay, and then quickly move on with the rest of their life and stop thinking about the issue. But that's the thing, when you are different and going against social norms, people have always thought that I was different and weird. So I have quite a lot of experience with it. So my next video will be all about going against social norms, because I'm a minimalist, a vegetarian, and that's all not very mainstream, not very common. So if you are interested in a video like that, please make sure to subscribe and hit the bell, because then you will be notified when that video is going up. Now let's do a reflection on the past 7 months without a car, because I was scared that I was going to regret selling our car. But I can assure you that we have no regrets. We actually love not having a car, and we don't miss the car in our day-to-day life at all. I started taking the bike to work last month, and it is absolutely the most peaceful start and ending of a work day. I really love that. It's also when we go to the forest with our dog. We used to jump in the car and drive to the forest, and now we go by bike, and the activity just really starts with leaving from home, and we also enjoy the bike ride and then our walk in the forest and bike back, and everything is a lot more cohesive. It's in a more calm pace, and that's just really nice. It really helped us with slowing down and not hurrying. And we do have to plan a little bit more every now and then. Just make sure to plan ahead, and we can't just jump in a car and take off. And it also just feels really good having a lower environmental footprint and doing what you can. So I hope to inspire you to take the bike more often and leave your car at home a little bit more. If you have any questions about living car-free, make sure to leave them in the comments down below. If you like this video, please give it a like. Subscribe, I already said that. Yeah, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye!